Hi everyone, welcome. So my name is Mila and I'm here with one of my colleagues, Kat, who's working on the back end in the chat as we go through today's presentation. We are from an organization called Inside Education. And what we do at Inside Education is we teach students and even teach teachers sometimes all about natural resources and the environment. So today at Safety Expo, we're going to be focusing on electricity and energy. So we'll talk about what electricity is, what natural resources our electricity comes from, and most importantly, since this is Safety Expo, we'll be talking about how to be safe around electricity. Before we dive into it though, I want to take a quick moment to acknowledge the fact that even though we're all coming together from different parts of Calgary today, we're all on land that has been stewarded and cared for generations by the Indigenous people of our province. So as we go into the weeds, nerding out on electricity and natural resources, let's keep that in mind. And going forward, it's really important that all of us play a role in stewarding our natural resources as well. Okay, so I know that you know that we all use electricity all the time. So think for a second just about some of the ways that you're using electricity right now. Maybe there's lights on above you, maybe your laptop or smart board or whatever technology you're using right now is plugged into the wall and charging. There's also lots of indirect ways we're all using electricity right now too, like the shirts that we're wearing, the masks that maybe you're wearing, the floor that you're sitting on, the desks that you're sitting at, all those products that we use every day took electricity to be produced and transported, sold at stores, manufactured. So we're constantly using electricity. Now, I want you to think for a second about if we need electricity to survive. Do you think we need electricity to survive? We know that we use it all of the time and we're really lucky to have electricity at our fingertips, but I would actually say that the answer to that question is no. There's people that lived for centuries before humans figured out how to harness electricity and survived fine without it. And even today, there's people in remote communities that are off the grid that survive without electricity too. But it definitely makes our lives a lot more convenient. And for people like us that are used to having electricity at our fingertips, it might be kind of hard to survive without it. Okay, so before we get too far into it, I want to make sure we are on the same page about what electricity even is. So some of you might be in the midst of your electricity and magnetism unit and know that electricity is the flow of electrons around a closed circuit. I just mentioned a few of the ways that we use electricity, but another really important thing is making sure that we use electricity safely. So we're actually going to play a game to get us warmed up that's all about electricity safety. So the way this game is going to work is I'm going to show you a photo, so a situation of someone using electricity. And your job as a class or as an individual, if you're at home today, is to write into the chat box if you think that is a safe or unsafe use of electricity. So I'll show you each scenario, maybe explain what's going on, and then I'll give you 10 seconds to write either safe or unsafe into the chat box. Okay, the first one is a guy who seems to be digging into his toaster with a metal fork because maybe his bread has gotten stuck in there. So is that safe or unsafe? I'll give you 10 seconds to get your answers in. So this is a really tricky curveball that I'm throwing at you right from the beginning here, because if we actually look closely at this photo, we can see that he's fully unplugged the toaster from the wall outlet. So technically, since he's unplugged the toaster and let it cool down, we could consider this safe. However, it's best practice and just best habit to never go into a toaster with a metal utensil like a fork. And that's because metal is a conductor, so it allows the electricity or the electrons to flow. So make sure if you're going into a toaster, just always use something that's not metal. So maybe like wood or rubber are much better options. And it's still also best practice to fully unplug it from the wall outlet. Okay, let's look at our next scenario. This looks like somebody has a power bar and they ran out of space on their power bar. So they plugged a second power bar into the first power bar. Is that safe or unsafe? Okay, so this might not be a scenario that you've heard of before, but this is actually unsafe. We sometimes call this an octopus outlet or an overloaded outlet. Basically, this is dangerous because if we have a total current that exceeds the rating on our wall outlet, we can end up with too much heat, which could start an electrical fire. Now, our devices are designed to shut off if they are overloaded. They have something called a breaker switch, so that should happen, but still best practice for us not to overload our outlets like this. So make sure you're not plugging a power bar into another power bar. Okay, let's look at our next one. So this is a transformer, a box you might have seen around your neighborhood. Do you think it's safe or unsafe to, say, play around a transformer? So is it safe or unsafe to play around one of these boxes? Okay, so this is a little bit of a tricky answer. These pad-mounted transformers are all around our communities, so they are designed to be safe. The electricity that's inside them is insulated from the outside world. But it's still kind of best practice not to be playing around them or spending too much time around them, because if one had the lock broken and the door ajar, it could be really dangerous if a little kid or an animal or a pet went investigating inside it. So what they're doing though is they're actually taking electricity from the transmission lines and then converting it into the current that can be distributed to our homes and schools and all the buildings in the neighborhood. So it's really important that we have these transformers and important that we're safe around them too. Okay, we're going to look at one more safety scenario. This looks to be a laptop charger and it seems to be kind of frayed. Do you think it's safe or unsafe to continue using this charger? Okay, so last answer is safe or unsafe in 10 seconds. Okay, hopefully everybody was saying unsafe. So we talked at the beginning about how metal, like a metal fork, is a conductor. The wire in this laptop charger that's exposed is a conductor. It allows the electrons to flow through it. The reason we have rubber around the wires on our laptop chargers is because that rubber is the opposite of a conductor. It's an insulator. It stops those electrons from flowing. But since that rubber casing has been frayed off, and the metal wire is exposed, if there's a current going through it and you were to touch that metal wire, you could get a bit of an electrical shock. Or if it's resting on something flammable, it could start an electrical fire. So it's really important to temporarily wrap it with electrical tape, but then eventually just take your charger to the electronics recycling depot and replace the charger. Okay, so there are tons more ways to be safe around electricity, and you can be a superhero, a safety hero at your own home if you're reminding your family members of how to be safe around electricity. So keep that in mind. We're going to move on and talk about where we actually get our electricity from. So you might know that we get our electricity from natural resources. And there are 8 main natural resources across Canada that we get our electricity from. So what we're going to do is we're going to play a bit of a game show to reveal what these 8 natural resources are. 4 of them are renewable. Renewable means we have an unlimited supply. So they're things that we can use without running out of them. On the other side, we have our 4 non-renewable resources. These are the ones that we have a limited supply of. They typically took millions of years to form, so we can't just replace them very quickly at all if we use them all up. So that's one of the things we have to keep in mind. Okay, so we're going to start going through these questions to reveal these natural resources, and we're doing it through trivia. So make sure you keep talking amongst yourselves with your class and also using the chat box to write your answers. This first question says, what natural resource uses photovoltaic cells to generate electricity? Hint, Alberta has more of it in the summer than in the winter. I'll give you 5 seconds for this answer. All right, so the answer is solar. So we can get electricity from the sun using solar panels, just like the one you see in that photo. Now, right now, even though we kind of hear about solar energy a lot, I would say solar right now is actually less than 1% of Alberta's electricity, but that number is on the rise. And there's some advantages of solar, like it's renewable, so we won't run out of the sun. There's not too much of an impact on the land. And once those solar panels are built, there's no greenhouse gases released into the atmosphere. But there's challenges with it too, right? Like it's not always sunny, so we need ways to store solar energy so we can use it at nighttime or in our long dark winters. And the upfront cost, even though it's going down, can still be a bit high to get solar panels. So what you'll kind of notice as we go through these resources is there's going to be good things about each one, but also challenges. So we're going to be kind of evaluating those good things and those challenges as we go. Okay, let's look at our next renewable resource. It says, what is the most used type of renewable energy in Alberta? Hint, head to southern Alberta, especially the Pincher Creek area, and you'll see lots of structures that capture this natural resource. I'll give you 5 seconds for your answers. Okay, so I hope we were all thinking of wind. Yeah, so has anyone seen a wind turbine like we see in this photo? There's lots of them, especially throughout the Lethbridge, Pincher Creek area if you take a road trip south of Calgary. But wind is 11% of our electricity in Alberta right now, and that number is on the rise. We have somewhere between 900 and 1,000 of these wind turbines, but there's more being built every day. So it's renewable, just like solar. We won't run out of the wind, no greenhouse gases. We have a ton of wind. It's really windy out on our grasslands. But some of the same challenges too, like it's not always windy, and can have a bit of a high upfront cost. Okay, so that's a snapshot of wind. Let's take a look at our next renewable. The question says, a dam allows us to capture this type of renewable energy. So the answer is hydro, or if you said water, that's a great answer too. So we can put a hydroelectric dam into a river to generate electricity from the water. Hydro is only 5 or 6% of our electricity in Alberta, and there's advantages to hydro for sure. Like, it's a renewable resource and we have lots of rushing rivers. But one of the biggest challenges is that building a big concrete dam like that in a river can have some big impacts on the fish and the plants and animals that are in that river, upstream and downstream. Okay, let's look at our last renewable, and this is gonna be the hardest one to answer. It might not be one you've heard of before. The question says, wood chips and crop waste are examples of this type of natural resource. Hint, it starts with bio. So it's bio something. Anybody knows? So the answer is biomass. So give yourself a big high five, pat on the back if you said biomass. Biomass is any organic, which just means once living material that can be turned into electricity. So in this photo, it's a bunch of wood chips. So this is actually a photo from a lumber mill. So a place where they're turning trees into wood products like desks and bed frames. And there's all these wood chips that are just a byproduct, which means they could just go to the landfill, but instead the lumber mill decides to burn them to generate electricity. So it does release greenhouse gases in that burning process, but at least it's using something that would otherwise go to waste. So there's pros and cons with biomass for sure, but we're seeing more and more of it in Alberta, especially in the forestry industry and also at farms. They'll burn or gasify their leftover crop waste and cow manure to get electricity. So those were our four renewables, which means it's time to move on to the non-renewable resource side. This question says, which natural resource has historically provided Alberta with most of our electricity? So until about 5 years ago, where did most of our electricity come from? And my hint for you, if this one's hard, is it's a hard black rock that comes from underground. So hopefully you're all thinking about coal. Yeah, so coal today, it depends on the day, but we only have 3 coal-fired power plants left in Alberta. And it's typically kind of like 20 to 40% of our electricity. But that number is going down quickly. We used to mostly use coal for electricity, but there's a big downside to it, which is that when we burn coal for electricity, there's a lot of greenhouse gases like carbon dioxide and methane that are released into the atmosphere. And those greenhouse gases contribute to climate change. So for that reason, our government has said that across Canada, we need to phase out coal by 2030. And in Alberta, we're actually on track to do that a lot sooner. So it's looking like by 2023, just next year, or 2024, we won't have any more coal-fired electricity. So some of the reasons we have used so much coal, though, is because we have a lot of it and it's cheap and we've had the infrastructure set up for a while. That means like the mining trucks and the power plants. But even though we're phasing out coal, we're not using any less electricity. If anything, we're using more as our population grows and we live more and more luxurious lives and as we start to electrify more things like vehicles too. So our demand for electricity is only increasing, which means we need to replace coal with something. And in the short term, this is what the next question is about. So which natural resource is taking over from coal as Alberta's main source of electricity? And it says, hint, it's also made into propane. Another hint is it's also the resource that heats our homes. Okay, so hopefully you were thinking of that blue flame that looks like suspense is building as the next slide loads, I guess. There we go. So the answer is natural gas. So we use natural gas for propane on some of our stoves, if you have a gas stove, for heating our homes, but we also use it for electricity. It has a lot of the same advantages as coal, so we have a lot of natural gas and it's pretty cheap to use, but it emits about 50 or 60% less greenhouse gases. So it's not, it's not perfect because it still does release some emissions, but it is a bit better than coal at least. Okay, we're going to look at our next question. It says, which natural resource is a fossil fuel often used to power generators in small communities? And the hint says, it is also made into products such as gasoline, asphalt, and plastics. What natural resource makes the gasoline that powers our cars? Okay, so the answer here is probably one we've all heard of in Alberta. It is oil. Let's see, come on, load. So while the slide loads, what it's going to show you is an oil rig. Now, oil really isn't used very much for electricity. It's really only used for electricity in small remote communities that are off the grid. And that's because they use something called a diesel generator to get their electricity from, and that diesel is made from oil. So the thing to really remember here is that we don't use oil much for electricity, even though we use it lots for other things. It's just in those small off-the-grid communities. Okay, I'm just gonna take a second to pause because my presentation doesn't seem to be advancing. So just bear with me and think about electricity. Oh, maybe we're back on track. Okay. All right, let's look at our last natural resource game show question. So there's one more resource we need to reveal. The question says, uranium is mined to produce which type of energy? The answer starts with an N. So what type of energy does uranium come from? So hopefully you're thinking about nuclear. Now, if this isn't one that you've heard of, that actually makes sense because we don't use nuclear energy at all in Alberta. But as we'll look at in just a little bit, there are other provinces in Canada that use a lot of nuclear. So there's some big advantages to nuclear. It's really efficient. So you only need a small amount of uranium to produce a lot of energy. But there's challenges with it too. It can be hard to get nuclear projects approved because of disasters that have happened in other parts of the world can make people a bit fearful about nuclear. Now, we've had nuclear power plants in Canada for decades without safety issues, so they really are safe here, but that can still be one of the challenges, is the public perception around nuclear. So like I said, we don't have plans for nuclear power plants in Alberta, but we are likely introducing nuclear in the form of small modular nuclear reactors, which you can picture as just small reactors that'll fit on the back of a truck and can be sent out to rural communities and industrial sites. Okay, so those were the eight main natural resources that we use for electricity in Alberta. Now, you might be thinking of some other ones we didn't talk about. Like, we didn't talk about geothermal. Well, geothermal actually isn't used for electricity at all right now in Canada. It is used for heat, though. You might have thought about tidal, if you've heard of tidal energy before. That's using the power of the tides for electricity. That is one that uses, well, water or hydro as the resource, but in a little bit of a different way than in our rivers. So there are more that are kind of coming onto the scene too, like hydrogen is another example, but these are the eight main ones that we currently use across Canada. So I know that as we talked through those resources, we I threw out some statistics of how much we use each one. So I just wanted to show you a pie chart of our electricity generation broken down by natural resource. This data is from 2020, and things have actually changed since then. So the natural gas slice, the red slice, should be even a bit more than it is in that pie chart, and the coal slice a little bit less. We're just waiting for the Alberta Electric Systems Operator to release their 2021 average year data so we can update the pie chart. But basically what you see is that natural gas is really dominant, followed by coal, followed by wind, hydro, some biomass, and then solar and oil are actually less than 1%. So when I plugged the numbers in for this pie chart, they didn't even register. And you might notice that there's no nuclear on there at all. And that's because, like I said before, we don't currently use nuclear energy in Alberta. So make a mental note of this Alberta pie chart, because we're going to compare it to the pie chart that shows all of Canada. And it looks really, really different. So you can see the big slice, 60% is hydro, followed by the orange slice is nuclear, followed by some natural gas and coal and the other ones mixed in there in lower percentages. But this is really different. And what this tells us is that there's no perfect natural resource for electricity. It's kind of about evaluating all these different factors, like the abundance of the resource, the population size of an area, the infrastructure that they have set up already, the cost, the environmental impacts, I said that one, all these different factors have to be considered. So we're going to break this down a little bit by working our way across Canada and figuring out what resource is used the most in each province and territory. So I'm going to be asking you some skill testing questions as we go. So continue putting those answers into the chat box or speaking amongst yourselves as well. So we're going to start with Prince Edward Island. So turn your geography brains on and think about our small island province on the east coast of Canada. So PEI mostly uses a resource that comes off the water in strong gusts. What am I talking about? What comes off the water in strong gusts? Well, I hope you're thinking about wind. So PEI is the only province that mostly uses wind for their electricity. Something like 99% of their electricity comes from wind. And it's partly because they have so much wind. If you've ever stood on the coast of an ocean, you know that it can be really windy. But it's also because they have a small population. So it's possible for them to build enough wind turbines to power their entire province. Next, we're going to reveal the resource that's most used by BC, the Yukon, Northwest Territories, Manitoba, Quebec, and Newfoundland. So think about the fact that they all are quite mountainous, lots of changes in elevation, which leads to rushing rivers. And rushing rivers are a way to get hydroelectricity. So it makes sense from that pie chart we looked at, we know 60% of Canada's electricity is hydro, so it makes sense that, well, six of our provinces and territories mostly use hydro. Okay, next we're going to look at Nunavut. So remember, Nunavut is the territory in northern Canada. They have lots of small off-the-grid communities that use diesel generators. So remember what I said earlier, what natural resource does diesel come from? Well, I can tell you it comes from oil. So even though oil doesn't make up much of our electricity overall, it is the main resource for electricity in Nunavut because they have so many of those small off-the-grid communities. So if it's a coastal community, they'll ship in that oil throughout the year. If it's an inland community, they'll truck it in. But a lot of these communities are trying to get off of oil for electricity and come up with other options. An example, not from Nunavut, but from northern Alberta, is a community called Fort Chipewyan. Just a year and a half ago, they opened up a big solar farm, and they're able to get a lot of their electricity that way. Okay, next we're going to look at Ontario and New Brunswick. So they use a resource that isn't used at all in Alberta. So remember what that one was? That one was nuclear. Yeah, so even though we don't use it at all in Alberta, it's the most used resource by Ontario and New Brunswick. So it's partly because they have such a big population there. And we know nuclear is really efficient. You only need a small amount of uranium to get lots of power. And they have so many homes to power in Ontario especially, that it made sense for them to invest the cost and the effort to build these nuclear power plants decades ago. Okay, finally, we're going to turn to Saskatchewan and Alberta. So Saskatchewan and Alberta have very similar geography and geology, which means what we have a lot of, Saskatchewan also has a lot of. So think about that. Think about what we said Alberta mostly uses, and then you'll know that Saskatchewan also mostly uses natural gas. Okay, so that's what our map of Canada looks like today, but remember that our electricity grid is constantly changing as we evaluate all of these different factors, and this could look a lot different even 10 years down the road. Okay, so it's one thing to understand that we get our electricity from natural resources, but it's a whole other thing to understand how that process actually works. So do you think that I can just take my phone outside on a windy day and expect it to charge from wind energy? I don't think so. Do you think I can plug my laptop charger into a jar of coal and expect it to charge? Probably not, hey? So what we're going to look at now is how the process of turning on a light bulb from a lump of coal works. So follow along with this story. We start by mining the coal from the ground and crushing it into tiny pieces. Then we burn the coal to get heat. And we use that heat to boil water. Off the top of boiling water, we get steam, which is able to turn a turbine. You can picture a turbine as big metal rotating blades. That turbine is connected to a generator. The main components of the generator are copper wire and magnets. They work together to spin and get the electrons flowing. Now, we have electricity, but it needs to be transported to our communities. So it goes through transmission lines to our homes, where we have things like light switches that allow us to open and close circuits and, say, turn on a light bulb. So that's how the process from coal to turning on a light bulb works. But of course, we talked about how we use a lot more resources than just coal for electricity. And we also talked about how we're phasing out coal. So let's think about how this process might work with wind. So with wind, we get to skip the couple of the first steps. We don't have to mine anything or burn anything and boil water. This time, those blades on the wind turbine itself are the turbine. So it's the power of the wind that turns those blades, turns the turbine. It's connected to a generator, which generates electricity, goes through transmission lines to our houses, where we can use light switches to turn on a light bulb. So knowing that's how it worked with wind, I want you to predict how it might work with water. So we know that we put these hydro dams in rushing rivers, which means that this time it's the power of the rushing water that's able to turn the turbine. And again, the turbine's connected to a generator. It'll go through transmission lines to a house, to a light switch, to a light bulb. So I hope you're catching on to the fact that as long as we can turn a turbine, we can generate electricity. Just how we get that turbine to turn varies depending on the natural resource that we're using. There's one exception to this, though. one of those eight natural resources that we revealed earlier does not involve turning a turbine. So I want you to predict, write it into the chat box or share it with a classmate, which do you think is the resource that does not require turning a turbine? I'll give you 5 seconds to think of your answer. So give yourself or your classmate a big high five if you said sun or solar. So with solar, we don't have to mine anything or burn anything or boil any water, and we don't even need a turbine. This time in the solar panel itself, there's these photovoltaic cells, and basically the light from the sun excites the electrons in those photovoltaic cells and gets them moving, which generates electricity. Sometimes solar panels are out on a big solar farm, in which case we'd still use transmission lines to get the electricity to our homes. But sometimes solar panels are right on the roof of a home or even on the roof of a school, in which case we can even skip the transmission line step. So I know we only went through a few of how those resources actually work for generating electricity. Just remember, they all involve a turbine except for solar. And if you're really curious about any of the ones we didn't go over, so if you're really curious about how the process works with nuclear or with biomass or with natural gas, just do some research and figure out how that resource gets the turbine to turn. Okay, so now I'm going to give you the chance to put on your decision-making hats based on what we know about the natural resources that we talked about today. So I've put your eight resources on the screen so you remember the eight options. And we're going to go through a couple kind of discussion questions. The thing to remember here is that there's no right or wrong answer to these questions. It's kind of all about thinking about all those different factors that we discussed. Okay, so question one says, which natural resource do you think is best for the environment and why? So I'm actually going to give 40 seconds to answer this question. So either talk with a classmate or put an answer into the chat box. So which natural resource do you think is best for the environment and why? Okay, so hopefully some of you came up with an answer. Now let me think. If you said solar, that's a great answer. We talked about how solar doesn't release greenhouse gases once those panels are built, and it's renewable, so we won't run out of the sun, and the impact on the land isn't too much. If you said wind, I would say that's also a great answer. We know that with wind, it's renewable, no greenhouse gases released once those turbines are built. Not a huge impact on the land, although maybe some impact on bats and birds and people's views in areas with wind turbines. Now, what about a non-renewable? If you answered nuclear, a non-renewable, that would be a great answer too. We know that nuclear is really efficient and quite clean burning. If you answered natural gas, great answer as well. We know that natural gas is reducing the amount of emissions released per unit of electricity we get out, especially when compared to coal. So again, no right or wrong answer, but hopefully you thought about that and also about the why behind your answer. Let's look at our next question. It says, which natural resource do you think provides the most amount of jobs and why? So again, I'll give you 30 seconds this time, I think, to answer with your classmates or into the chat box. Okay, wrap up those combos, but I hope you carry them on later. Let me see. If you were thinking maybe oil or natural gas, that's a great answer. We all know that our economy in Alberta is largely based off of oil and gas. We probably all know people that work or worked at some point in the oil and gas industry. So we know it provides lots of jobs. Maybe if you're thinking coal, that's a great answer too. A lot of our communities, smaller communities in Alberta, were developed because of the coal mining industry. So there's lots of jobs from the mining trucks to the transportation of the coal to the power plants. Okay, now, was anybody thinking about biomass? We talked about how biomass is often with a forestry industry, like at a lumber mill, or it could be at a farm. So yeah, there'd be lots of jobs at that lumber mill, including the person who is burning those wood chips for electricity. If you thought of wind or solar, those are great answers too. There's more and more jobs in wind and solar across Alberta. There's jobs in research, so improving the ways that we build solar panels, improving the technologies so they can collect solar radiation off of the ground or remove snow automatically, just as a couple examples. There's work in constructing or building solar panels and wind turbines and maintaining them, making sure the operations are safe. So, yeah. Basically, all of these natural resources come with jobs and can help our economy. One last question for you. This last question is maybe the toughest, but it says if you could choose which natural resource all of your electricity comes from, which would you choose and why? So 30 seconds to think about your answer for this one and go. All right, so yeah, this question is tough because, like we talked about at the beginning, there's good things and challenges with all of these natural resources. So it's really hard to pick one that's just the be-all, end-all best natural resource for electricity. And I mean, if there was a perfect one, that's the one that we would all be using. So it's kind of about thinking about the right mix for your area, right? Thinking about all those factors we talked about that include jobs in the economy, environmental impacts, abundance, population size, how easy it is to extract those resources, and even more factors than that too. So hopefully this got you thinking about natural resources and maybe what the right mix that you would like to see Alberta have 10 or 20 or even more more years down the road would be. But I encourage you to continue having this conversation, this discussion with your classmates later on. Okay, so I mentioned at the beginning of the presentation that whenever we talk about natural resources, it's so important to come from a place of gratitude. So gratitude for having these resources and gratitude for the people that have lived here for thousands of years and been good stewards of these resources. Stewardship means taking actions to protect something you care about. And I think we're all on the same page that we care about natural resources because we use them for electricity, but a whole lot more than just electricity. We do types of recreation where we use our forests and our land. We use energy in different ways. The products that we wear and use every day come from resources. So we want to make sure we have them for a long time to come. Now, what I want to kind of close off with is to have you think about what you can do to conserve natural resources. So I am going to put up some of my own ideas of things we can all do on a daily basis to help conserve natural resources. And I want you to put some of your own ideas in the chat as well. Okay, so a couple of these first ones are all about conserving electricity. Since we know that electricity uses natural resources, if we use less electricity, we can ultimately use less natural resources. So things like unplugging electronics or having all the electronics in your classroom on a power bar so that it's really easy at the end of the day to shut off the power bar, just unplug that from the wall and turn off all of those electronics at once. Of course, turning off the lights and when you're not in a room that you're when you leave a room, switching light bulbs to more efficient types like LEDs. So incandescent light bulbs waste a lot of heat energy unnecessarily. So switching to more efficient technology like LEDs can go a long way. Now, these next few ideas are more about being responsible consumers, since we know everything that we use and do comes from natural resources. So fixing broken items instead of always buying new things, recycling and composting, packing your lunch and snacks in reusable containers, shopping for your school supplies or clothes at a thrift store so you're not always buying new, and biking or walking to school if you can. So those are just a couple of ideas that I had, and I hope that you're already doing some of these things, but I'd encourage you to put your own ideas into the chat or to talk about them amongst yourselves. So, with that, I just wanted to say a big thank you so much for attending our session about electricity and energy. And I hope it inspired you to be stewards of our resources, and it also inspired you to be a safety superhero in your home by teaching your friends and family how to be safe around electricity. So with that, we do have some time for Q&A, and I'll just turn it back to our host to tell me if any questions came in.
So Mila, we did have a few questions earlier in the chat. One of the questions was, are batteries an energy source?
Ooh, great question. Are batteries an energy source? Yeah, so batteries are one of the ways that we can store energy. And so they kind of become a source of energy in a way. But in order to charge a battery, we need natural resources. So an example is, well, we have these solar lanterns that we bring to schools and build with grade 9 students especially. We can use a solar panel to charge up the battery, which can then light the lantern even when it's not sunny outside. So batteries aren't really a source of energy because you still need the energy to come from a natural resource, but they are a way of storing energy. I hope that kind of makes sense.
That's great, thank you. And then the other question we got earlier was, is nuclear energy bad?
Ooh, good question. I don't think that nuclear energy is bad. If nuclear energy is produced in a safe way, which it is in Canada, like I said before, we've had nuclear power plants in Ontario and New Brunswick for decades and decades without safety issues. So as long as it's safe and as long as there's a safe way to store the waste, the byproduct from nuclear power plants, then it's not bad. It can actually be a really clean burning and efficient source of electricity.
Perfect. And then another question we got was, when will we go completely wind or solar?
Ooh, when will we go completely wind or solar? You know, I wish I had a crystal ball for you to predict that answer, but I don't. All I can say is that wind and solar are two of the resources that are increasing pretty quickly in Alberta. Wind is on average 11% of our electricity every day, and solar right now is just under 1%, but increasing pretty quickly too. I can say it won't be within the next few years that we've switched completely over to renewables, but you know, maybe farther down the road than that we will. And if that's something that you're really interested in and passionate about, and if you've learned about all these resources and think that renewables like wind and solar are the way to go, then I encourage you to maybe even go to a school program where you get to learn how to work on wind turbines or solar panels, or go into that industry.
Thank you. Another question that came in was, what should we do with old batteries?
Oh, great question. So what should you do with old batteries? You should definitely recycle them, but not just in your normal recycling bin that you put out on the curb. So it takes a little bit of extra effort, but it is worth it. There are electronics recycling depots around the city. So just do a Google search and you'll come up with an idea or a list of where to bring them to in your area, close to your school or house. Also, a lot of battery stores, like I was just at a store called Battery World in Calgary the other day, and they actually recycle batteries for you too. So you can bring them into a battery store, check with them first, but a lot of them will recycle batteries for you.
Perfect. And then another question is, how do you know how much energy you use?
Oh, that's a great question. Well, the way to know how much energy you use, if you're talking about how much energy you use at home, is you'll have to talk to your parents. So your parents or whoever owns your house, they pay electricity and heating and water bills every single month. And they'll get a report that tells them about their usage and then calculates the total amount of money they owe. So you can look at those reports with them and find out how much energy your house is using. And same with your school. Go to your admin and see if you can get your hands on the energy use records and see how much energy your school's using. Maybe you'll identify some areas that your school could maybe use less energy and be better, more responsible consumers in that way. Start a little school action project too.
Perfect. And then one more question is, can you generate your own electricity or energy at home?
Oh, that's a good question. Can you generate your own electricity at home? There's some ways. So if you were to set up, say, solar panels or even a wind turbine on the roof of your home, you could generate electricity. And there are more and more grants or rebates out there to bring down the cost for homeowners to do that, and also for schools to do that as well. Another way is there's pedal generators. So you can actually ride a bike, and then that movement energy from pedaling can go through a generator and be converted to electrical energy that you can then use. So you could also set up a pedal generator or a hand generator too in your home and get a workout and also generate electricity.
That's awesome. Another question is, I've heard of vampire power. What is that?
Oh, good question. So basically, when our electronics are plugged into a wall outlet, even if the electronic is completely turned off, there's usually still a bit of a current being drawn from the outlet. But that's completely unnecessary, right? Like, say you've got your vacuum plugged in and you're not actually using it, it doesn't need to be drawing any power, but it still is drawing a bit. That's what vampire power is. And that's why it's really important that we not only turn off our electronics, but also fully unplug them from the wall outlets. So earlier when I was talking about power bars, it's actually even better than just turning off the power bar to turn off those devices. It's best to just pull it out of the wall.
And there's no more questions. Maybe we'll give it a few more seconds to see if there are people who will ask. Okay, looks like there is one last question. Is there a safety checklist?
Is there a safety checklist? Oh.
I wonder if this is a question relating to what's safe and unsafe that you had asked us in the beginning.
Yeah, because we just went through four examples, right? But I said that there's more ways to be safe around electricity than that. I'm not aware of a checklist of all of the ways to be safe and unsafe around electricity, But that's definitely something that I should look into and something that you should too. I know that, so our partner, the group that funds us doing this electricity program, is NMAX, and they really prioritize electricity safety. So it's possible that they have a resource like that that has the complete list of all the ways to be safe around electricity, but I can't name it off the top of my head for you.
And we have 5 minutes left, and we have one more question. What can we do at school to save energy?
Ooh, great question. There's lots of ways you can save energy at school. So you can make sure that all of the light bulbs in your school are LED. LED stands for light emitting diode instead of incandescent. They're just much more energy efficient, and they last a lot longer. They last about 25 years. So make sure you're using energy efficient light bulbs at your school. Make sure the lights are being turned off whenever nobody's in a room. You can go an extra step and maybe try to get automatic lights at your school, just so everything's automatically turned off at light at night, just in case people forgot to manually switch off some of the lights. You can check with your admin or the staff at maintenance staff at your school what the thermostat is set to. Maybe there's opportunity to turn the heat down by just a couple degrees, and for a big space like a school, that can save a lot of energy and money, and just encourage your classmates to put on a sweater instead of having the heat up so high. Water, so we use water in the taps, of course, but it's not only using water, it's also using energy, because our water that we use for showering and washing our hands is heated. So that's using natural gas or energy. So making sure you're not leaving taps running when you're not using them is a big one. Let's see if I can think of one more. I would encourage you to do an energy audit of your school. So you can take devices like an infrared thermometer is one example. You can buy an infrared thermometer for $30 off of Amazon or at Canadian Tire. And you can go around your school hallways and identify if there's any windows or doors where a lot of heat is escaping from your school. And then you could go to your staff, your teachers, and say, hey, I think we should patch up this area. We're losing a lot of heat unnecessarily, and we could be using less energy and even saving money if we patch up that heat loss spot. So that was just a couple ideas off the top of my head, but I hope you've got some more that you'll be able to implement at your school too.
Okay, just 3 minutes left, so I think this might be the last question. Where do you get energy efficient things?
Where do you get energy efficient things? Well, so there's a few examples I could think of energy efficient things. We talked about LED light bulbs. Those are sold really in any like hardware store now. So Canadian Tire, Home Depot, Walmart, wherever light bulbs are sold, LEDs will be sold. For things like automatic like thermostats that'll turn down the heat when maybe at nighttime or when you're not in the house throughout the day, when you're out at school or parents are out at work, you can get those kinds of devices also from hardware stores. So yeah, I would just do some kind of like researching around those kinds of stores like Canadian Tire and whatnot, and see what they have. And lots is available online too these days.
That's great. Thank you. Are there any more questions before we finish it off? We'll just give you guys a few minutes here. All right. I don't think we're getting any questions, and we're a minute from finishing. So we're going to call it here. Thank you so much, Mila, for coming to present today, and Kat for helping answer some of the questions. And of course, Catherine. We thank you. We hope you enjoy the rest of Safety Expo if you're going to be joining us tomorrow. And have a great rest of your day.
Thanks, everyone. Bye.